Please stand and join me in the pledge of allegiance. I pledge
allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, I'd like to welcome everybody to the council meeting this evening. The first item is the consent agenda. It's a group of items that are to be acted upon with a single motion and vote. The consent agenda is designed to expedite the handling of limited routine matters by city council. I will ask if a citizen or council member wishes to have any specific item removed from consent agenda for discussion. And at that point, if either member of the public or council wishes to, they may request that an item be moved from the consent agenda prior to the council's vote. The items on tonight's consent agenda are approval of the work session and regular meeting minutes for April 26, 2016, approval of the expenditure vouchers of May the 10th, 2016, approval of a special events permit for the Cortez Area Chamber of Commerce for hosting event on May the 12th. Is there any item that anyone would like to have removed from this agenda?
I don't see any.
All right. May I have a motion?
Honorable Mayor, I make a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented with the addition of $5,326.81.
Second.
Yell. Archibek.
Aye.
Lucero.
Aye.
McLaughlin.
Aye.
Carlson.
Aye.
Miller.
Aye.
Sheik.
Aye. We have no presentations at this time. If there is a citizen in the audience that would like to step forward and speak before council, you may do so. Would you please come forward and state your name and your address?
Hello, members of City Council. My name is Deb McVicker. I work at the Montezuma Cortez High School. I just say when my address.
Yes.
My physical address?
Your address.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, where you live.
It's 16045 County Road T in Cajon, Colorado. The reason I wanted to present to you a proposal this evening, basically in a nutshell what it is proposing that we bring a dormitory environment for students at the high school. And this dormitory is to help improve our graduation rate, which right now is suffering due to home environments. Based on some research that I've done and some experience that I've had with students in the classroom, I find that many students go home to an environment where they cannot do their studies. And I believe that a dorm would provide them with a safe home in which they can complete their studies and to help them to graduate. And so the reason I'm presenting this to you as City Council is I believe it's a community issue as well as a school issue. And I'm seeking funding for this project. And I really don't know where to go to seek that funding. And I'm hoping that you could give me some suggestions on how I could fund a program such as this. And I also have a copy of the draft of the proposal, if anybody would like a copy of that.
Are you talking about building an actual physical facility within the city limits?
Yes, ma'am.
And have you thought about who's going to staff it? Or
yes, that's all in my proposal.
Do you have copies of that for everybody?
I do. I have six. I guess I don't have enough for everybody. I wasn't sure how many would be here. So would you like me to distribute those?
Yes.
All right.
You can take them on. Okay.
Not me, ma'am. Thank you.
Sure, I'll take them.
chair.
And if I haven't run out of time, I would take questions. Otherwise, I don't really have anything else to present. I just really need an action plan on where to go from here on how to obtain funding.
Are there any other programs like this anyplace else that have used as a where do they get their funding?
Yes, they have one in place right now in Bloomfield, which has a very, very similar demographic as us in Cortez, with the percentage of Native Americans, Asian, and Caucasian. Mm-hmm. And they also have a very successful dormitory program down in Shiprock, which is on the BIA reservation.
Is it operated by the BIA?
Yes, it is.
Okay. So that's federal funding then?
Yes.
And is the one in Bloomfield federal funding?
From my understanding, yes, it is.
Then have you checked with the feds?
I have, yes. I've spoken to the personnel in charge, and she has stated that they do receive federal funding. She didn't say that was all the funding that they received. She just said that it was partially federally funded.
Does placement within such a facility like this require parental consent?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Your dormitory, is it like 7 days a week? Would they go home on weekends? How does that usually work?
It would be 7 days a week, and if they want to go home on weekends, that would be a decision between the parents and the student.
How many kids would this probably entail for a school of our size, or Cortez, a resident of Cortez?
Well, in doing the research, I came up with 5 to 10% of our 630 students, and so that only comes out to be like less than 20 students. So I'm looking at housing them at no more than 25.
No, it was 5% of 630?
Mm-hmm.
So it would be 31.5?
So that would be 30. Okay, excuse me.
Are most of these facilities located on campus, or are they located off campus?
The facility itself, I would prefer that it be very close to the school. Not necessarily having to be on campus, but it could be as close as across the street, which I'm sure you've all noticed is a big vacant lot.
How would you decide which students get the privilege of staying at a place like this? Like, what would be the process of deciding who gets to stay there?
That would be a very rigorous guideline. The student and the parent would have to be both on board with being very serious about graduation. And I had a student personally that I took into my home and allowed her to live with my family for 3 months of her graduating year, which helped her to be successful at graduation. She now lives in Denver, and she goes to culinary arts school, and she's doing great.
Would parents be responsible for providing part of the room and board for these students?
That would definitely be something that we should consider. But at this time, I would like it to be fully funded without the parental assistance.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask.
I guess it would depend on their income and if they were able.
I was going to say, that's a pretty good size of budget that you got here.
Correct.
Average.
Yes.
That's what I was wondering when Carolyn's mentioning about the charging to be in there or not.
So have you taken this to the school board, and are they on board with it?
I have taken it to our superintendent, Ms. Hockness, and also I spoke to Mr. Dan Porter, who's in our HR director. I also spoke to some principals at our school, some staff, students, and I really feel like it's a positive move for the school. A lot of students are prepared to write letters saying that they would participate or would like to be, a participant in this. I also have family members, and I'm trying to put together some more support materials, with personal letters.
Would this just be high school students, or are you looking at elementary and middle school?
No, it would just be high school, ma'am.
Just seniors, or?
9 through 12.
Oh, four.
So you could feasibly have a student that stayed in this facility for all 4 years of their, would it be during the summer months as well?
No, it would not be during summer months. And yes, they could possibly stay all 4 years.
Does your budget include costs for food for the children?
Yes.
Have you talked to the housing authority?
No, I have not.
Is that because the housing authority and social services are looking at certain types of housing where, I'm not sure whether this would be something up their alley or not, but you might as well ask, where they'd have families live and there will be different kinds of classes come to the families, and it's all on site, and it, instead of having them just have an apartment and go places, there'd be classrooms in the part of the building. So they might be interested in something like this, they might not.
That might be something Pinion Project, too.
I have spoke to the Pinion Project, and they are very, very supportive.
Okay. The Housing Authority, could you repeat that, Mike?
There's some new kinds of affordable housing that are what they call transition housing, and there's a couple groups have been talking about trying to do them, and they involve social services, and it's basically at-risk families that need to go from the real bottom of the pile to where they can figure out how to live in an apartment and get their kids together and get, you know, get all the help they need so then they can move out and be on their own. There's a place up in Grand Junction does it through the Women's Resource Center. I've had some people that I'm aware of, I've had some clients go through that. And it's similar to this, but different. But I mean, it might be something the Housing Authority would be able to steer you in some directions. Terry Wheeler would be the contact person.
Thank you. I'll definitely look into that.
Well, your best initial bet is if there are facilities close, and there seem to be in Broomfield and then Shiprock, mm-hmm. that may be the very first place you need to go to sit down and talk with them and find out, you know, where do they get their funding? How do they go about getting it?
Yes.
What kind of letters of support do you have to have? Can they give you just a general step-by-step process of what needs to be done in order to, mm-hmm. to move forward on a project like that?
Okay.
Because they've already done it, and they apparently have done it successfully, and you could probably get your best answers from somebody who's been through the process and mm-hmm. is open and working at it.
Have you gone to the tribes?
I have not. That's a great idea.
Because some of those kids might be tribal.
Yes. Yeah, I'm sure several of them would be.
And I would wonder, would this be specifically for the Cortez High School? Could Dolores High School kids, could SWOS kids, would it be open to any Montezuma County high school age youth, or would it be specific to Montezuma Cortez?
I guess the only answer I could give you to that would be when we do get funding, if there was any limitation on the funding, that I would have to follow those guidelines. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't know until we actually got funding and to see where that would play, you know, take into play.
That would be where these existing organizations might be able to help you too. What are their, what guidelines do they use when making
Yeah, selections? I just think that the challenges kids have to graduation, I mean, that's kind of the point of SWOS, right, for kids who've struggled and they need a different environment. So I think that we'd have a pretty big, you know, possibility of kids that could take advantage of it from SWOS as well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, SWOS is part of our district, so they would have to be, you know, candidates.
Does that help you? Have we helped
yeah,
you?
I mean, I'm just, I'm right now, I'm just really looking for ideas on, you know, where to go from here. I really feel that this is a need in our school district, and it would really help our students. Mm-hmm. And it's just been a real burden on my heart, and I want to try and help.
I think Mike gave you the best advice. I think the Housing Authority, just because they do administrate so much federal money's coming through, they're aware of a lot more programs than I think anybody at this table is. You know, that's definitely their bailiwick. So I think starting out with Terry Willard, the Housing Authority, would be a great start. And then also, like Mayor Shigg said, you know, if you've got two really close examples that have done it, you know, they may have kind of a golden brick road for you to follow the money that way, too.
Okay. And I guess I want to ask, do I have your support as a city council? Is this something you would support as a council for our town?
I think, really for council, they really should have something kind of official in front of them. I think it's kind of hard for council to take official support on a concept.
Okay.
You know?
Sure.
So I think the city's always been really supportive of education and youth and, you know, so, but it's a little bit hard to, I think for council, yeah, we support you when you're not really looking at anything concrete to support.
We need to know a lot more details. I mean, in theory, it certainly has potential.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time. All right, we have no public hearings, no unfinished business, but we do have new business. Terminal building lease extension to the TSA bus.
Good evening, council.
Good evening.
Hello. Okay, the first of three agenda items I have is the extension of the TSA lease. I think we're all familiar after 15-plus years of what TSA is and what they do and where they operate. They do have two offices rented at the airport terminal building, and we charge them historically the same rate that we do the airline. The airline and TSA are the only two entities in the building operating under a square foot price basis for their operation. The car rental being the only other entity in the building, they operate on a percentage of gross. So we are, or they have requested a five-year extension. That's the extent that they can go, and that will carry us beyond the current airline lease. So I had to think forward beyond the airline lease, because their lease ends in December of 18. So I had to carry out our progression beyond the 18th. So whatever we would normally have on a longer airline lease, if it went further than the 18th, I extrapolated that out to June of 2021. So that's where we come up with the final figure of $19.77. So I will use this as my template for a future airline lease. Are there any questions? This will have a positive fiscal impact on the airport budget, by the way. We will garner an increase of $4,400-plus over the next five-year period due to this increase in rental rate.
Are there any questions?
I don't have any questions.
Okay, then may I have a motion, please?
Madam Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to approve the TSA lease for 5 years, commencing July 1st, 2016 through June 30th, 2021 at the increased lease rate.
Second.
Archbeck?
Aye.
Carlson?
Aye.
Keel?
Aye.
Lucero?
Aye.
Miller?
Aye.
McLaughlin?
Aye.
Sheik?
Aye. All right, the BLM land lease at the airport.
Okay, another federal entity at the airport. They lease land, in this case, to have a temporary quasi-tanker base. They've had it there for about 12, 13 years, and they supply the slurry that small single-engine air tankers do on hotspot forest fires. The bigger tankers that you see in the newsreels and all of that, they come out of Durango. We don't have the capacity to handle those tankers. So these are the single-engine air tanker. We have also can service heavy-lift sky crane helicopters and Puma helicopters out of there with the same agent. So they've got a lease there for a plot of land that is within our hangar row, if you will, on the south end of the hangar establishment, and they also can only go to the extent of a five-year lease. Now, I'm trying to bring these into a calendar year anniversary date. I wasn't able to do that with the TSA folks. They wanted to stick strictly with the five-year and end it in June. So that one stays as is, but the BLM folks were willing to work with us on that. So it's going to be a four-year, eight-month lease, which will roll us forward to a January 1 anniversary date in the future. So it's a four-year, eight-year lease period. We prorated the first year at $854 partial year, and then subsequent years will be billed on the full year rental rate. We are increasing their rate to equal what we now charge for land leases for hangar construction, which we've done, I don't know, 9 or 10 of them now. So everything's even, Steven, above board on that. They're not paying any less or any more, just exactly the same. So this is another lease extension, not a renewal of an entire lease. It's basically addressing just the term and the new rental rate. Any questions?
And this is 22 cents you're charging.
We did charge 22 cents. Now it's being charged the 35 and a small fraction.
Okay. Because when I was reading this,
if you're reading in the original lease, it might be 22, but the new lease is at the new rate.
Okay, I see. All right.
It's on the second line in the second. Mm-hmm.
I got it. Okay.
It says it'll be increased from the 22.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions, Council?
Does that cover all the costs that they? In other words, does that cover all the costs of them being there, having?
We really don't have any cost other than them occupying the land. They have a water tap into the property so they can mix their slurry, but they pay their own water bill.
That's, well, you don't have, there is any cost.
Right, other than occupying the land. Right.
Okay, any other questions? May I have a motion?
Madam Mayor, I'd make a motion to approve a four-year, eight-month extension to the Bureau of Land Management land lease at the Cortez Municipal Airport at the newly established land lease rate.
Second.
Lucero.
Aye.
McLaughlin.
Aye.
Miller.
Aye.
Carlson.
Aye.
Keel.
Aye.
Archbeck.
Aye.
Sheep.
Aye. And finally, the T-hanger rate increase at the airport.
Okay, we assumed the T-hangers about 8 years ago when the FBO, which previously it had that under their lease, they surrendered the T-hangers. They were no longer interested in renting out the T-hangers and going through the collection process of the rent and so forth. So we took it on at the same price they were charging, which was $50 a month at that time. And they had increased that price from $40 to $50 a couple of years prior to that. So we're 10 years now into this $50 a month, and inflation alone is reason enough to raise it. So even accounting for inflation, it came up to just a hair more than $60 using the CPI figures on the government website, but I rounded downward to the nearest whole $5 mark, which was $60. So we'll probably revisit this from time to time on a more frequent basis rather than waiting 10 years. But or there's a standing agreement that if John or Jane Doe come into the airport and say, I'm going to build new T-hangers, then we will knock these down because they're in pretty poor shape and they don't have a lot of eye appeal. Those of you who have come down to the airport and taken the tour have seen that, so we may not have to address this again if somebody goes forth with that.
Any questions?
I
have a motion.
I move to approve the increase of $10 per month and the T-hanger rent through December 31st, 2020.
Second.
McLaughlin.
Aye.
Miller.
Aye.
Archbeck.
Aye.
Carlson.
Aye.
Keel.
Aye.
Lucero.
Aye.
Sheep.
Aye. Thanks, Russ. Catch you before you get out the door. All right, letter of support for low-income housing tax credit. Shane.
Thank you, Your Honor. The city has been approached by the Treadstone Group, asking for a letter of support. They have recently purchased the Valley Sun Village property, which is on East 2nd. There's, if you're not familiar with it, there's a picture on page 27 that may refresh your memory. This is a 50-unit complex. They're all one-bedroom. They serve the need for seniors that need low-income assistance. So, you know, I think that's a credible need in Cortez, clearly. And these folks have a project to spend about $66,500 per unit to make improvements. It'll be Energy Star fixtures. It'll be ADA access. It'll be exterior improvements and interior. And the great part is they're not looking for any money from the city. So they're just looking for our letter of support.
How many apartments per unit?
I think just one. There's 50 units, and they're all one bedroom.
Oh, okay.
And so I think it's, I recommend letter support be signed by the mayor.
So it's not a complex.
It's all different.
So that's a little houses, isn't it?
Yeah, they're like two units.
And they're like little duplexes that go around in this.
They're planning on spending
$66,500 per unit, right?
Well, it's their total. I guess I didn't do that math. It's their total budget is $3.3 million. So I could look. I don't know if that's per duplex or whatever that is. So but yeah, it's a big improvement. And basically, they're looking for these HUD tax credits. If they get the housing tax credits, it's 9% back to them, so it's a pretty big incentive. Right.
Okay.
Oh no, that's divided by 50 and 66,000 per unit, so that's per one bedroom unit. There's 66,500.
So that's amazing.
They've been there a long time. They need some renovation. Yeah. I think this is a great program.
They need fixed up in case we go there.
Yeah, when I'm ready to rent one of them, I want them to be nice.
you weren't even born when these were built, Orly. I don't know what you're talking about.
I still got 60 years to go.
Sorry. I just want to let everybody know that I actually represent Valley Sun Village, and so I'm going to recuse myself from voting for this one. So. Okay.
Does Jill have to leave the room?
This is just a letter of support. She's going to not participate, and she's not going to be in the discussion.
So. So if it doesn't look to be going your way, please don't like stare at council. Or
no, and I'm.
Don't like this.
I'm fine.
Okay. All right. If there aren't any other questions or comments, can I have a motion, please?
Madam Mayor, I move to authorize the mayor to sign a letter of support for the Treadstone Group, DBA Valley Sun Partners, to receive low-income housing tax credits for redeveloping Valley Sun Village.
Second.
Miller.
Aye.
Archbeck.
Aye.
McLaughlin.
Aye.
Lucero.
Aye.
Keel.
Aye.
Sheik.
Aye. Shane, I don't recall when I was reading this, was there a timeline as to when they're thinking they'll have these done?
I don't remember reading that timeline.
Okay.
They just gave us the summary. These folks reached out to me about 2 weeks ago. I think the timing for CHAPA is pretty tight, and these groups really are benefited by a local government support. So they gave me the summary sheet, and I thought, okay, it's...
Sounds good.
Yeah, it sounds good.
All right. Roy, the IGA between the Colorado Television Translator Association.
As you recall, sometime for the past year, we've been doing we went and got a grant from DOLA to extend our radio system into the Mancos area, into part of La Plata County. To do this, we've got to have a tower, and we've got to have a place to put the equipment. The television district stepped up and said, we'll be willing to partner with you. And so that's what this agreement is us partnering with them for us to put our equipment in the building at the foot and use their tower. So far, the money situation is not, we're not having to pay anything extra at this point in time. I do suspect that if electricity or some of the utilities go up because we're there, they may come to us and say, we'd like for you to penny up and pay for those. But they've been wonderful to work with. It's been a great group of people, and they're really helping us out, probably saving us a couple million dollars because one of those towers will cost you $1 million to put up.
Does anyone on council have a question about this?
Mm-hmm. I don't. Nope.
Then may I have a motion?
Honorable Mayor, I make a motion for you to sign the intergovernmental agreement between the Colorado Television Translator Association and the City of Cortez for the purpose of expanding the state's 800 megahertz radio system.
I'll second.
Miller?
Aye.
Archibek?
Aye.
Keel?
Aye.
Lucero?
Aye.
McLaughlin?
Aye.
Carlson?
Aye.
Sheet?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thanks,
I appreciate
Roy. Thanks. 2016 vehicle bid. Rick?
Honorable Mayor and City Council, the 2016 equipment fund budget provides $130,000 for the purchase of three police department vehicles. One of those is a right-hand drive Jeep, a small mid-sized van, and one patrol pickup, and one utility pickup for the Public Works Department. Also joining in this bid, the 2016 Water Fund also provides for one utility pickup for Public Works, budgeted at $40,000. So the total budgeted amount for equipment fund and the Water Fund purchases would be $170,000. Specifications were drawn up and bids were received on April 19th. Unusual this year, we received two local bids to our request. And then these bids were then compared to the Colorado State bid system. Also attached to the Colorado State bid number was our local vendor preference amount and an estimated delivery amount from Denver to Cortez. Very quickly here, bid item one, which was the full-size half-ton four-wheel drive extended cab with the police package. The low bidder was New Country, $27,529.73. Bid item two, the full-size three-quarter ton four-wheel drive regular cab pickups with the utility bed. And this year we bid it with an optional snowplow package, so to help with snow removal. There again, New Country was a low bidder, $41,020.31. Bid item three, a small cargo van to be used at the kennel. The low bidder was Kazee Motors, $24,564. And bid item four, the right-hand drive Jeep. The only vehicle that in the United States you can get a right-hand drive is a Jeep Wrangler, so that's why it was pretty specific. New Country Auto, $30,221.40. So the recommended purchases in the equipment fund would be $123,335.44. The water fund again would be $41,020.31 for a grand total of $164,355.75, which is $5,644.25 below the budget amounts.
Well, Let me just ask you clarification for myself. Under bid item two, it says two units. So that's two vehicles at a total?
Correct. One out of the equipment fund and one out of the water fund.
Okay. So the okay. So each unit's $41,000.
Correct.
So we're actually buying six vehicles. Five.
Now you can make
five
me
vehicles.
Five. Yeah, then five items. Two, four three, bid three, items, five. One of them is
we're
two.
Buying five, right. Okay. All right. Any other questions? Everybody else can count. May I have a motion, please?
I make a motion awarding the 2016 vehicle bid as follows. Bid item one, the one unit for low bidder New Country, the bid amount of $27,529.73. Bid two, two units, low bidder New Country, bid amount at $41,020.31 for each unit. Bid three, one of the units, the low bidder Kaziz, for the amount of $24,564. And bid four for the one with the low bidder New Country, the bid amount of $30,221.40 for the grand total $164,355.75. I hope it comes a good stereo.
We like, we like your total there.
McLaughlin?
Aye.
Archbeck?
Aye.
Miller?
Aye.
Keel?
Aye.
Lucero?
Aye.
Carlson?
Aye.
She?
Aye.
Thank you.
That's right.
Thank you.
Okay, the grant agreement between Dolan and the City of Cortez.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, as you all know, the city was fortunate enough to receive a $2 million grant from DOLA for their reuse remodel, the new City Hall building, 123 Roger Smith. As I updated you in the workshop, we actually did open up our bids on Thursday. So I basically wrote this memo, then went to the bid opening. That'll be presented to council in 2 weeks, but all three of them were right at $2.5 million. They were, it was crazy how tight of a bid package we actually had. I mean, I think that it was maybe $12,000 between the low and the high bidder, and that's on a $2.5 million project. So it's extremely tight, which is good. Our architect did a great job. You know, the last time we met with council, with architect, I think that they had the estimate around $2.3 million or so. So this is higher than we'd hope. But we also knew with the hospital project, with the Osprey, with the county, you know, everything's going up a little bit based on all the construction. So the good news is we've got the grant to cover, again, about 80% of this project.
Does this include contingency funds? So, because no
project. You know what? We didn't have any detail on this. We don't actually have all the pricing detail, but I would highly assume that $2.5 million has all the contractor contingency and everything in it. So the next step, once council awards the low bidder, then we'll have a chance to sit down with them and the architect and really value engineer and say, okay, well, geez, you know, what about this feature and what about this? And so I believe that that number is going to come down after we see what decisions we're making. But I don't think we can really do that with the low responsible bidder now unless we give everybody that option. And that seems a little bit disingenuous to have a bid opening and then start negotiating with everybody. It seems to me a little bit more ethical to go with the low responsible bidder. So that's a tangent. But anyway, so we know that. If council approves this, we are going to overnight it tomorrow. I'm going to really try to get the grease under this thing to be signed because we can't award a contractor bid. We can't actually sign with the contractor until we've had it back executed. So we can't encumber any funds. But I think we did that one other time when we really tried to expedite it, and they actually got it signed pretty quick. So I'm here for your questions.
There's no problem with expediting the process of talking with the contractors about possible places where we could lessen the cost?
Well, I think
prior to this being signed?
Well,
DOLA grant?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, we could absolutely do that. There's no issue there at all. And again, I really hope to have this back. And last time she actually emailed me and said, it's all been signed. You should get it in a couple days. But I was still okay to encumber the funds. But I think that the last grant, like with the Toyoak Waterline, after council approved it, it was a solid month until I actually had that back at my desk. So the kind of the normal course of action, it takes a while to get everybody to sign it. Because it's numerous people in different offices that have to sign it. And so, like, the comptroller will get it in his inbox and finally sign it, and then they'll send it over to somebody else. And
when we get an email verification saying that it's okay to go ahead and award the funds, is that as good as it having it signed in front of us?
Yeah. If they say you're good to go, I will print that out. I will frame it on my wall if any question comes up.
And we can start spending money.
Yeah. So, again, I contacted the state last week and let them know we're going to overnight it tomorrow. So I'm doing my best to push it through.
Okay. Any other questions?
None.
May I have a motion?
Yeah, I make a motion to the grant agreement between the State of Colorado Department of Local Affairs and the City of Cortez.
Second.
Yes. Oh, wait. You know what? I read that wrong. Sorry. I'd make a motion to accept the Energy and Mineral Impact Assistance Grant 9113, Cortez City Hall Renovation, and to authorize the mayor to execute the agreement. Sorry about that.
Second.
Keel.
Aye.
Lucero.
Aye.
McLaughlin.
Aye.
Carlson.
Aye.
Archibek.
Aye.
Miller.
Aye.
Sheet.
Aye.
I was in a hurry to get that email.
Send it. Mr. Johnson, the commercial lease agreement with Lawson Construction.
Good evening, Madam Mayor and members of the council.
And Mr. Johnson.
This is something that actually happened before with South Broadway project, but the property was actually owned by Four Corners at the time. Lawson Construction was awarded that project as well, and they set up their staging area there. It's a perfect location. It's flat. It's clear. It has security. We can sell them water from our tap that's available, and it's really going to, I think, help the project out, and actually it's a really good spot. So when negotiating with the owner of Lawson Construction, we came down to $1,500 a month for the term of 6 months for $9,000 total, and they're going to demo the scale house, the scale foundation, and any associated infrastructure around it, which we would have to do when we develop that property anyway. So that's going to be in addition to the lease payment as well. So it's a really win-win for us, and we'll have to cooperate and work together, I guess. But I think it's a good thing. So, and so does CDOT. And I always like to keep the skids greased with them.
Yes.
Does anyone have any questions on the memo or the amount or anything like that?
You said 6 months, right?
Yes, sir. And plus or minus.
Yeah. It's not going to be like our neighbors.
I'm not going to evict him on 6 months plus one day.
Yeah.
I see that there's a termination clause. If they terminate early, are they still contract bound to pay the $1,500, or does that cease?
Well, that's a good question.
The way I read it was we walk away.
Right. But the fact is that we're really the only game in town for this, and they're not going to move in and then leave. They're going to move in, and they're going to finish, complete the project, and make
this
it right
is more
for us.
This is more than a parking lot, too, right? It's a batch plant.
Right. It's a concrete batch plant, yep.
So there's a lot of stuff that once they set it up, we'd have to really make them mad to get them to move.
Well, like Phil just said, I don't know where on earth they're going to go. I mean, we're easily the best location for them, really close, nice shot.
What would we be doing to make them mad that they would leave?
I used to say
our inspector.
Our inspector.
I mean, this company, CDOT, contracted with to do the work, didn't they?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so it's not us that's going to be making them mad. It's going to be CDOT. Okay, if there are no other questions, can I have a motion, please?
Madam Mayor, I'd make a motion to authorize Shane Hale, City Manager, to sign the commercial lease agreement with Lawson Construction Company to lease 5 acres of city-owned property in the Industrial Park expansion area while Lawson is working on the Highway 491 Lebanon reconstruction project.
Second.
Lucero.
Aye.
Keel.
Aye.
Miller.
Aye.
Carlson.
Aye.
Archibald.
Aye.
McLaughlin.
Aye.
Sheehy.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good night, Ms. Johnson. You too.
Letter of support for tax credits for the Calkins Building.
Thank you, Your Honor. Sir, I was on the wrong page. So the city has been in contact with the Owl Company, which is Becky Barber. Most people on council have met her for many months in order to figure out the best way for the Calkins Building to be rehabilitated. She does have a contingent offer on the school district or with them to purchase the building, so she's not the owner. She was recently successful in placing the Calkins Building on the National Historic Register, which council all knows about. So in order to make this project profitable, she's attempting to garner tax credits. So she's both looking for historical tax credits and through CHAFA for affordable housing units. So as you'll note in the letter of support, you know, just reviewing the city's comp plan, we have a lot of sections that are really supportive of this. We say we should encourage rehabilitation and preservation of historic buildings, sites, and districts by private entities. It also encourages infill development, development of safe and affordable housing, and specifically the appropriate development of the Calkins Building to attract pedestrian and automobile traffic. So, like the earlier one, I think that this is a pretty easy ask for the city. We're not being asked for any money at all. We're just being asked to support the project, which I think in itself is a worthwhile project.
Now, has she purchased this from the school district?
She has not.
She thinks she's still under contract, didn't she?
I believe so. I believe so. And I think, I don't know the details of it, Councilman, but I believe that she's trying to get some ducks in a row, things like these tax credits lined up before she closes on it. She doesn't want to end up with the Calkins and, right, and the inability to develop it.
They've already drawn up some elevation plans, though, some site plans.
And they've been meeting with planning and building staff, so they're not
There's motivation there.
Yeah, they're really motivated.
And it makes sense for her to get those tax credits in line prior to. That's a good point. I have no further questions.
Okay, then may I have a motion?
Honorable Mayor, I authorize you to sign a letter of support for Becky Barber to receive low-income housing tax credits and or historic tax credits for redeveloping Calkins Building.
Second.
Archibald.
Aye.
McLaughlin.
Aye.
Carlson.
Aye.
Keel.
Aye.
Miller.
Aye.
Lucero.
Aye.
Sheehy. Aye. All right. There are no draft resolutions or ordinances. At this time, we've had a citizen request for allowance of manufacturing and cultivation of marijuana in the industrial park. Shane.
Thank you. So the city allows growing, cultivation, and sale of marijuana to occur in the CDP and commercial zone properties of the city with some additional restrictions that include distances from churches, schools, and other facilities. The rules that govern marijuana sales in the city were developed after research, deliberation by an ad hoc committee, staff, city council, and the public at large. And I think at least the majority of council sat through a significant number of public hearings and work session groups on those. So council has been requested in the past to consider rural operations in the industrial park, but heretofore has opted to restrict this use to the current zones. So for discussion, Mr. Mark Rogers would like the city council to change the zoning laws to incorporate marijuana growth facilities in the industrial park. So just for reference, the three main objections in the past, I think from my memory, from the ad hoc committee, from planning and zoning, from staff, from citizen testimony, et cetera, were that one, if it's up in the industrial park, it's another section for the PD to patrol more often. The PD does patrol the industrial park now, but this size of grow, I think, would kind of compel the city to look after more often, and so it would just be this additional patrolling. The second one discussion was that the city doesn't impose an excise tax, so because of Tabor, we couldn't just impose one, it needs to go to the voters. So any kind of large grow operation would have no financial incentive to the city. It would just be what it was. Third, when we first put marijuana restrictions in place, council put in a cap of four, said no more than four facilities in the city. After he took some business testimony, I think council decided, fine, we'll let the free market do it, we'll regulate by distance. But with that, right now we have, I think, 6 licenses out there. I think that we could hit 7 facilities or more in the commercial district right now. So we do have a lot of facility potential in Cortez currently. And then the final thought, I just let you know, because you guys don't hear these things, but staff gets contacted quite often by growers that would like to, I mean, in the last month we met with a group that wanted to bring to the city the idea of allowing on-site consumption, doing like kind of a little marijuana co-op, and they wanted to let people go and exchange and smoke and do whatever. And so we said, well, council is here to force it, no on-site consumption. And then I was just contacted by another group that wants to do, I could just describe it as a marijuana mini mall. You know, it's a developer that wants to build a large complex and have a lot of people in there, you know, a lot of different businesses. And so I just want to just kind of put it out there that as we look at changing the code, I think if we start changing the current code, we're really opening ourselves up to be approached quite often. So I just give you all that for food for thought. So you don't have a current proposal in front of you tonight. The attorney has admonished me, and make sure to admonish you, that there is no straw pulling tonight. Council shouldn't say I would vote for this or I wouldn't vote for that, because clearly there's nothing to vote on. So I would say, after discussing it, I would acknowledge that Mr. Mark Rogers is in the audience if you have questions from him. But really, the discussion really from council should just be, I'd consider changing the code, bring us back something to look at, or I need more information on the topic to consider, or the third would be, I don't think the changes are warranted. So if we can just kind of get that in direction and not have anybody really vote and say what they would or wouldn't do, Mike won't have to jump out of his seat.
I think that what I'm reading, and I could be wrong and Shane could correct me, is we're talking about rezoning the whole industrial park, not just one piece.
No, it wouldn't be rezoning. It would be...
Or not rezoning, but changing the use.
It'd be amending the zoning in the industrial park to allow that as a use.
Mr. Right. Rogers uses the words change the zoning, but what we actually would be doing is changing the use. And I go with the words. And then I go. That's actually quite an involved process, but we would be adding a new use to the industrial park.
Have we ever added a new use to the industrial park?
Last time was adult entertainment. That's the only place in the city.
There's adult entertainment in the
industrial park. Yes, well, and that was a reason.
The Supreme Court basically said that you can't zone out sexually oriented businesses. So I think every municipality in the country said, okay, where do we allow them? And a significant amount said in the industrial park.
That's the last change I'm aware of.
I just thought I'd been missing out on stuff all these years.
No.
But it wouldn't be unprecedented as far as looking at uses in different zones. That wouldn't be the unprecedented factor for doing that, I think, as far as considering. At P&Z last week, we talked about craft breweries and where they could be allowed in different zones. So I think that's, you know, I think it's appropriate for council to consider what different things can go into different zones, and that's not unprecedented at all.
Could they do brewing of beer in the industrial complex?
And is that so? Yeah, because actually right now how we define it by code, it is processing of food, so the industrial park is a place where they could manufacture alcohol. But that wasn't the question. Actually, the question in front of P&Z was looking at our central business district and possibly neighborhood business. So I don't want to cross that. But it was looking at zones where we don't actually allow it right now.
Okay. Well, Mark, would you like to take 3 minutes and give us your take?
Thank you. Mark Rogers. We've met. So what my proposal is to add that to the industrial park. Now, I control, of course, my building as well as the other corner of Industrial Park. So there's approximately 20,000, about round figures, 20,000 square feet of existing building, round figures, that could be utilized for growing operation, what I have control of. I have with me as well as Carlos here. He represents another person in the industrial park that would like the ability to lease their buildings or sell their buildings to someone that would do the have a growing operation of what we're. What I'm proposing is just growing operation, no commercial, other than no like a dispensary type operation, none of those kind of things. So just growing. Now, I would suggest the industrial park area would be for growing. Now there's currently Osprey PAX is going to be vacating their building because they're going to build a new building, and they have also indicated that would be a possible use for their building. There will be vacating another building which they currently lease, which will also be vacant. So as well as my building, there are several other adjacent buildings that would like the ability to lease their buildings or sell their buildings to businesses for the purpose of growing marijuana.
We just have a huge marijuana farm in the industrial park then?
I'm sorry?
We're just looking at having a huge marijuana farm in the industrial park with all of these buildings growing marijuana?
There could be, or of course you could be one or as many as you'd allow. Now, I would look at the potential for job creation that just in my little building, if it was allowed to do marijuana, the people that I've talked to me about leasing my building would generate at least 15 jobs in my one little section. So if you would say the other two buildings that I manage on that corner. If those were allowed to also be part of my building complex, if you will, or whatever, you would see possible job generation of another additional 50 jobs. And these aren't, you know, low paying jobs. They're, you know, starting at $15 an hour up. So that would generate a job in that area, just my little corner of, you know, of 50 to 75 jobs just in my little corner. Not and decent paying jobs, not, you know, cheap stuff. And, you know, the thing that next door to me, you guys allowed the pot shop there, and they generate quite a few jobs. But the thing that I visited with a few of the employees there, and they even have health care benefits at the pot shop. But I can't afford to give health care benefits to my employees that I currently have at the restaurant, but they can have health care benefits. So not only will these be decent paying jobs, but more than likely they can even have benefits. So it's a benefit to me, to the city, just because of the job increase, and we need jobs for the city, for people in the city, which generates tax revenue for the council and for the city and so on. So there's a huge benefit that's the possibility of doing of increasing allowing these facilities for growing operations. Now, first of all, I don't think it should be allowed in the state, but it is here. It's already been allowed. You all have allowed it in the city. So if it's allowed in the city, it seems to me that the reasonable and the logical location to have operation such as this, where it's controlled, is in the industrial park. That is my thought.
Are your buildings rented out now? Do you have occupants in your buildings now?
I'm sorry.
Do you have occupants in your building now? Are they being rented out?
I have in my building, my personal building that I own, it is occupied only by my business interests, my construction and so on. And the other two buildings that I manage, it is being occupied as a rent, as a storage facility, which is zero job creation, zero job input for the city. So if those buildings plus my building could be allowed to be a growing operation, therefore gives us the job increase that is just my buildings. If Carlos, the building that he represents is the old care building, they would like to be able to do something with their building. If Osprey PAX vacates the current building that they operate out of to their new building that they're going to build, plus the building that they currently lease, which is the old Flexi Rocks building, those two buildings will be vacant. And with the oil patch like it is right now, it's not likely that they will be leased anytime soon. So we're going to have some more vacant buildings in the industrial park with no use at all. This industry, the pot industry, seems to be going crazy across the state. If you'll notice headlines, Denver is growing. There are something like, I think the last I saw was something 2 million square feet of buildings in the Front Range area that are being used for pot growing operations. So the industry seems to be going that direction. These buildings will be vacant. It seems to be a good use for these buildings. I've been checking with air quality people, because one thing that was concerning to me and also to Sam was they stink. If you've ever been up to the one up on top of the hill, just caddy, you know, down on the end, you know, if you've been up close to it, it smells. Of course, they don't have to do any mitigation for the air quality because it's kind of out there by themselves. Of course, in the industrial park, it's not, so we would have to address the air mitigation or the air quality problem. And the air quality people that I've talked to said that is an easily addressed situation. The smell can be mitigated, and so that it's not noticeable at all. Okay. So you can purify the air before it ever leaves the building or can contain that smell issue. So that is an issue that can be mitigation. My buildings, on the security issue, my buildings, the area that I control is all secure, has security fence, 6-foot security fence around the whole perimeter. So it is a more, it's a whole lot safer area to control than all the many pot shops that you have along the street. None of them have any other security on their buildings other than just the alarm systems. My buildings have security fencing and are easily excuse me, taken care of as far as security goes. Of course, with the things that the state require, there's all kinds of security alarm systems, video systems, and so on and so forth. So it would be that situation that you were talking about as far as patrolling the area would be easily overcome. Now, theoretically, I mean, you would think that the security system would, for like Osprey PAX right now, would be already to being taken care of. Of course, the city service center, they have a lot of valuable equipment, so you'd think that a little extra patrolling wouldn't be a hard thing to do. There also, you would note that the jobs that these would generate would increase the city sales tax. It would increase all those, the services that generate income for the city, so maybe a couple extra patrolling wouldn't be cost prohibitive. But, other questions?
Thank you. Any other questions?
What sort of licensure? Have you looked into state licensure?
State requires a lot of licensing and for these type of operations. I have not. You have to go and get, you have to have approvals and so on from the state to do a growing operation. Now, we're just talking about growing, not dispensing, not, it's just a wholesale growing operation. Now, the city can. Other cities have done this, and they have introduced, I think it's an excise tax, I believe, that they charge these operations for growing. Since there's not a sales tax revenue for the city, but there can be an excise tax revenue for the city as well. So as well as the job creation, there can be an excise tax generated for the city as well.
Does the city have to, would we have to vote on that?
It would have to be a vote, and it would be, it's a narrow, I think the one Mancus has, it's actually an occupation tax, and there's a way you tax each unit sold. I'd have to go back and look at it. And then, like I say, you'd have to have an election and work your way through it. And that excise tax would also affect the existing businesses, because if we did it for grows, they have grows as well.
Is that how the facilities on the Front Range did it? They have excise tax imposed?
Some do, some don't.
Well, they had to in order to comply with Tabor, right?
They would have a vote.
They would have to go to a vote for it, but they wouldn't necessarily have to have
it. To be an excise tax. Just a lot to vote of places as to whether they allow it or not and keep the regular tax for the city?
That's right. Okay.
The other thing that I'm seeing here is you're being asked sort of directly, sort of indirectly, to change your distance requirements, which is to get below the 1,500 feet. When he starts talking about more than one location in the industrial park, there's some distance requirements that we've passed that might only let one building up there be allowed, one property owner.
One property.
Right. Well, one property owner. So your buildings that you have up there, like I say, the one you own might get allowed, but not the other two or three next to it. Don't know. It'd be something to have to look at. The buildings that gentleman owns might not be allowed because they'd be within there.
It's pretty close to up on Lebanon Road.
So yeah, we didn't allow one down on the highway because it was too close to the existing. So there's a lot of things at play here. The licensing thing is quite complicated. It's not easy to license one of these facilities. The security systems, the systems that they keep track of the plants is more than just cameras. There's not radio tags, but there's tags that can go with readers and everything. So, we can do what council wants, but it's a bigger project than just changing.
Okay.
Staff will be taking on quite a few duties as far as it's not just going up and driving by and shining the alley lights on the building and making sure the doors are all secure. Somebody's going to go up there and count plants. Somebody's going to look and see what the manifests are. There's a lot more to this than just letting somebody grow some plants. And
well, and all those things are taken care of by the state regs. State regs insist on all those things that you just mentioned. So really, it's not something that you have to deal with as a city.
It is. We do it. We do it. No,
you have to. You have to make sure it's done. But the state has those regulations. I'm sorry.
The state of Colorado is here doing that inspection a couple times a year. All that falls on the city of Cortez.
Sure.
It's our officers doing that. So it is our compliance officer that does that.
And our fire inspection.
Hopefully, the job creations will help with that deal. Do you not wanting job creations?
Well, but it's when I hear like 50 to 75 jobs, I just don't know what on earth that's based on, Mark. It seems a bit.
Well, it's based on my neighbor telling me that's what they. They have a facilities on the Front Range that's 150,000 square feet facilities, and they have hundreds of employees. I was basing that on his information that he relayed. John Seckman, one of the owners of the building next door that have their growing facilities in the Front Range. Mm-hmm. Of course, now they do all their facilities in the Front Range and they ship it down here so we can sell it. Of course, there are two facilities that the dispensaries that have small growing operations within their facilities. Mm-hmm. Garrett on the Hill, the guy on the Hill, he was also said that there'd be about 15 plus jobs on my small operation. Expanding that to include the other buildings, that's where more people would come into it. So,
do we know what the possible impact of having a grow facility in the industrial park would have on other businesses wanting to be in there?
Don't, but it some of the problems that Mr. Rogers has talked about, odor. We've had some complaints about one of the stores down on Main Street over the time, and that really affected the business lady, the business next door. She was rather angry. There's a lot of things here that could affect business, and one of the ones is we don't even know that he can get a license if we approve this. I mean, this is sort of a crapshoot.
Well, there's no sense in trying to get a license until it is approved.
But, I mean, there's a lot more to this, seeing those jobs, seeing everything happen, than simply changing the use. So, we can do whatever you folks want to look at and bring you back more information. We can look at things. We could get someone from the police department and the planning and building department to say how it would impact them. We can get you more information so that you could make an informed decision. Ask informed questions of us and get a recommendation from staff, move forward. But say yay or nay and that it's going to do all these wonderful things is purely speculation, I think, at this point. Given my experience with the places we have in town and what we've gone through with them.
I think there's a lot of parts of this conversation right now that are speculative, Mike, and I would prefer some more information personally.
Going to mention more information on it, but one thing real quick, what you mentioned, like there's four or five buildings they're talking about up there, so whoever goes first, that's the one that's going to get it, right? Because
it could very possibly be. We've seen that sort of disproved over the last few months with actual getting out on the ground and measuring the distances. But yeah, I mean, if the fellow there that Mr. Rogers brought to support him gets his thing in first, he'd be the one with the license.
And I don't know, for growing operations, isn't it the purely the city's discretion of how many is located? Could there not be more than one in the industrial park?
You have to meet the 1,500. You have to meet 1,500 feet from each other.
That's the city's regulations.
Right.
It's not the state's.
Right, but you can't do it in the city unless we allow it, and if you try and build them too close under our distances, you don't meet the requirements of the city, so we wouldn't be allowing it.
But he's asking us to change our regulations, so he's saying...
If you change regulations in the industrial park, could
that
be done?
You want the distances changed,
too. Should the council be asking me these questions? I'm sorry. Questions with the council.
I asked that we were asked to look at three things, and mine is I would like some more information.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Yeah. So
I'd like to see more information on it, see if it's even doable.
Well, short answer is yeah, it'd be doable. I think we just need to change the code.
But what are all the impacts so forth?
Well, and
not just speculating, but
our impacts though aren't as speculative. I think it would increase our police department's time up there for sure. We need more, depending on what council wants to consider. But if we're considering moving the distance requirement or removing that, it may really have an impact citywide if we don't have a distance requirement any longer.
There couldn't be a distance requirement different in an industrial complex for growing, for dispensing?
Mm-hmm. I think you're going to probably have a lot of operators in here, our existing businesses coming in, raising some grief with council. If we change the code and give a more liberal zoning distance in the industrial park than we have for everybody else, my guess is council would get substantial pushback from a lot of people.
Definitely some pushback.
Right. So yeah, I mean, I think short answer, I think council could do different rules in different zones. You absolutely could do that. That's a short answer. I just think it would be, I think we're going to have a lot more meetings like this.
And what you would have is every time somebody wanted to start a new marijuana business in a new district in the city, or one end of the city or the other, they'd come in and say, well, you changed the distance requirements for them to do this, so why don't you change them for us? So it's a slippery slope, because things just start snowballing.
How about we see who wants more information and just go that route?
Could I ask another question? Now, currently, I could. There's acreage for sale on the south side of town, for example, on Highway 491. I could buy some of that acreage, and if I had the wherewithal, I could go in and build a 20,000 square foot building. Currently, because there's that space that's still available with our 1,500 foot laws and so on, I could build a building down there with the existing way it is right now and do that out on that out south side of town. Is that not correct?
I'm not sure, to be honest, because
it's within the 1,500 foot limit, and you could do a dispensary or / grow operation right now. Is that not correct, Linda?
We do have a license pending just south of Lots of Pasta.
And there's one more spot available within the city limits, past that one that is pending right next to Lots of Pasta. There is room down there. I know Gil was working on the property, and he since has backed out of that. But so I could go down there and build a 20,000, 50,000 square foot building and do it right now. Mm-hmm. So what I'm saying is the buildings are already in the industrial park. Would you rather not have the buildings that are already existing that really don't have much of a use without the oil patch going like it is, or would you rather have a new great big 20,000, 30,000, 40,000, 50,000 square foot building along the highway for a growing operation that is legal to do right now with the zoning that you have? So what I'm saying is, wouldn't you rather have it in the industrial park out away from everybody's homes? That's all I'm saying. Wouldn't that be a better place to have these type of operations? Now, and it's already there.
I think we all, perhaps at this point, agree that we need some additional information. We need to talk with the police department. We need to talk with other city staff to see. And frankly, I think
I'm just planting the seed. And if we can, you know, work on it from there, that's all I'm asking you, is to think about it and look at it and say, well, what are the possibilities and what are the problems? There may be some problems. Well, can those problems be mitigated? Can they be solved? Can we, you know, move forward into this and help everybody in the city with? Can we look at it?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I think the decision, if we could even say we've made a decision, is that we need more information.
I'd like to look at more information myself.
Okay, so just so I have somewhere to go from, what kind of things would council like? So I'm not really certain what.
I think we need to know what is going to, how much additional is it going to tax the police department? And if you can break that down into dollars and cents, what's that going to cost us? So we're going to have to hire some additional people in order to be able to patrol that area.
And some of that may be speculative based on, I don't know if council is looking at, you know, how many are we going to have here? You know, is it with the 1,500 feet? Is it without the 1,500 feet? Because, you know, that would be different. And then, I mean, we could pull, like...
Well, how hard would it be to have a different zoning requirement in the industrial park compared to the rest of the city? I mean, those types of things, the logistical right. part of things sure. is something I'd like to look at. The litigious side of things as well. Could we examine what goes on some of these larger grow facilities on the Front Range and see what type of issues they have with crime, robbery, things of that nature? Do they get robbed a lot? Do police in these areas use more patrols in these areas? I think these are all statistics that we could find fairly easy.
So, Shane, there was a lot of research done by an advisory committee that was put together by the community when all this, when the marijuana first became legal. And they came up with the recommendations of not to allow these facilities in the industrial park. Could we, by chance, review those findings and why they...
It was very simple. It was they wanted things to be out in the open where everybody could see them, and they resorted to, I don't want to use the word supervise, but to maintain a, you know, safety, and they didn't want things where there wasn't a lot of police presence.
Well, as so part of the information that we're asking to look at, I think that'd be a good idea.
But that's basically what I'm remembering all that decision came down to. There wasn't a study with numbers and things like that. It was basically staff said, we'd like to keep it where there's a lot of people,
but it wasn't all just staff that came up with that. I mean, that was a community advisory committee, if I'm remembering
but
correctly.
What I'm trying to say is they didn't get into any kind of an analysis like Ty's asking for. It was just pretty much... It was decided it was going to be in these, the highway district, the commercial district, if you will, because of traffic being there, and it would be easier to be seen instead of someplace where patrols weren't regular.
But was that for retailing marijuana or growing it?
At the time, it was only for medical marijuana, which was a mixture of both growing and selling, because the medical marijuana people seem to want to grow their own more because they want to control the product more. The retail's a different ball game because
the state statute had the vertical integration where they the medical
you had to grow it.
Right, that's what I'm saying, but we had that you had to grow it on site. We added that, and then retail's a whole new ball game where it's kind of more like a liquor store where you bring up your stuff and coming in with it.
Well, that's why I was just wondering.
Yeah, the medical was, we didn't do another one for retail. So the first, the committee was mainly on medical marijuana. And so there was, like Shane's pointing out, some different parts of that that really don't necessarily apply here or may. But we can get you that stuff, but I'm not remembering much of it.
I think part of it, too, came under that $1,500 distance requirement, right, too. Because once you put that in, that limits... And we had businesses that were already in place, so well, this business now, where's the 1,500 feet from that? So it began to fairly quickly narrow where you could have additional facilities for anything because of the others that were there and the schools then, the presence of schools.
What's the max number of facilities, growth facilities would be in the industrial park if we had the 1,500 feet?
Zero idea. I mean, we could pull that through planning and zoning. I have no idea how many could be allowed in there.
Well, how far is Garrett's operation?
Yeah, I mean, that's right.
I would guess that the 1,500 feet walking would count the care building out. That would be my guess, because it's just right there on the hill, but we do say walking distance, so as you go down that road, who knows, maybe it's 1,520 feet.
Right now, from the guy on the hill to my location is about a little over half a mile.
So we could certainly, I mean, that's easy to go, and if we started out with one to see with the 1,500 feet, about how many we could have in there, but I would think, I don't know, three more, four more, depending on where they're located.
Residences, people that live nearby, how do they feel about this?
They're all in the county, aren't they? Across the road on L.
So it would be across L then.
Yeah. Okay. And then the ones that, I don't know. And like I think what Shane pointed out before, too, is the distance requirement is kind of speculative because whoever gets in first up there would further limit growth. So maybe there's two, maybe there's three. I don't know. It's like if Mr. Rogers gets it, if I'm understanding where his property building is, Osprey wouldn't be able to. That old building would be out of the mix because it'd be too close.
I've never heard that.
But I mean, that just to say that building would be too close to be used because it's right across the street. So we'd pretty much have to almost get rid of the distance requirement up there to get some of these buildings
just in that zoned area. Now, would it be beneficial to see what other cities are doing as far as that goes, like on the Front Range or other areas, and see what they're doing and what adverse effects that they're having in their areas? See what's going on.
Yeah, yeah. I just mentioned that. I think that's where we start with, as far as gathering information, because that's kind of the direction council's already set.
And it's been a while since we've looked at that, and I think Roy and I have talked on and off, and there's a lot of different things that have happened, good and bad.
So there's some history now.
Yeah.
These kind of facilities, they use a lot of water, don't they?
A lot of water, a lot of electricity. Uh-huh.
Are the utilities up there capable of doing everything?
Sam says yes, so I'd have to go with that. And
Orly
I've heard different,
yes.
Heard different things depending on how your grow lights are and everything. Don't know. it's an interesting energy-consuming business.
I mean, the water line capacity up there is ample for the water side. And I would guess all of those buildings are, I don't know if it's three-phase up there, Orly. It is, so there you go.
But load-wise, you can't predict that either till you find a final load sign. Mm-hmm.
And that's what some electricians have told me, that until you have the system in there, you don't know whether the building's adequate or not until you can figure out what you're going to put in for lights and ventilation and the scrubbers and everything for the, like he's talking about, the smells. Those are all. So, yeah, it's a lot of, Ty says it's a lot of speculation, and we'll get you information.
I'd be happy to provide all that for you if we have a possibility of looking at it, and if you need more information, I'd be happy to acquire all that information that's necessary. So tell me what you would need, and I'll get it for you. And once again, the only reason that I'm looking at it at all is the possible income generation of it. It's what these people are willing to pay for lease, phenomenal. What I can get for it right now, it's, you know, five times as much what they're willing to pay what I'm getting now currently. So that's why I'm looking at it.
Okay. All right.
Thanks, Mr. Rogers.
All right. Thank you.
Anything else?
I think we're good.
Okay.
Right. Is there anybody else that would like to speak to council? Yes? Please give us your name and your address.
My name is Mark McLaughlin. I live at 234 North Chestnut Street. And I would like to address you about Chestnut Street. I'm not sure if you're aware, but it has 5 to 10 semi-trucks that travel down Chestnut Street every day. Before they redid the whole 491 cutoff thing, I never noticed as many trucks. But now it seems like we got a lot of trucks that come down our street. And there's a lot of kids that play on the street. And I'm just afraid of an accident happening. Chestnut Street is as it goes downhill. Most of the trucks that are coming, they head north. So I think they're missing the 491 cutoff. I've contacted GPS Fleet Services and asked them if the Chestnut Street was a truck route, or an alternate truck route. And they said they don't have it marked as an alternate truck route. And they said that if I got the city to put up no truck traffic, they would put it on their thing. I've also been talking to Rick Roth with CDOT about the signage, because I think the trucks are missing the turn. So they're coming to Chestnut Street to get back to 491. So I was wondering if we could get a no-through truck sign. There's the mill that sits between Market and Chestnut Street, and they have trucks that come and go, but they don't go through. They go to the mill, and then they go out of the mill, so they're not really through traffic. So
are they going through to Empire then?
Yeah, they go all the way through to Empire, and then they turn to go back to 491. You know, kids ride their bikes. You know, if a kid were to run out in front of the truck, they'd go, because it is downhill, they get to go in like 30 miles an hour by the time they hit Abercamp. And it would be really hard for them to stop. Plus, I see them, you know, on their phones or whatever. So yeah, I just think that no through trucks would be a good safe.
Is that something that could be done fairly easily with that? Do we have to make a motion or?
I would say no, that's not something the council should do easily. I would offer that we have Empire, we have a lot of streets where trucks cut, and so I would think we want to look through the police department and public works, because again, my guess is we would get asked to put them up on probably quite a few other thoroughfares in the city. In the past, when council's talked about truck routes, it's opted not to do that. So I think we would probably need to look the whole city street plan, not just pick one specific street for that.
What's the speed limit on that street?
25 and was posted otherwise throughout the city.
It's not posted otherwise on that street at
all. No, it's 25. Okay.
I would just like to point out that, I mean, Chestnut Street is a pretty residential street, and I can't think of any other residential street that really has 5 to 10 semi-trucks traveling down it per day, you know.
We've had complaints about Empire, though, specifically, and there are a lot of residences on Empire as well. So I'm just saying I would highly advise the council not move to do that without doing a bigger consideration.
Is this something that can Roy station some people there to just kind of check to see what kind of traffic we're having?
And that was one thing that Rick Roth from CDOT said, is that if I could have the chief of police do a courtesy stop on a few of these trucks, just to ask them why they were coming down Chestnut Street. Because, I mean, other than missing the cutoff to 491, there's really no reason for them to come down our street.
Where are they coming from? South on 491, on to Main, down Chestnut, and back over to 491 north?
Well, I don't know where they're coming from, but it seems like that.
Right.
Because they...
And they're not mill trucks?
No.
Huh. Because I couldn't understand why it wouldn't save them any time if they were coming south on 491 onto Main, cut down Chestnut, back over to 491 north, like if they're through trucks, big semis.
So they're coming off of Main onto Chestnut, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, they're turning north onto Chestnut off
yes,
of Main.
Yes.
Roy, is that something you can, is that something that you, tell us what you guys think.
I got an email from a gentleman today, and I went over there and a couple of times today, wasn't able to see any trucks coming. What I could do is we can see if we can contact a couple of them. I don't know, I never heard of a courtesy stop before, but maybe we can find out why they're using that street and see if we can do something that direction. It's a 25 zone as long as, so. But I understand his problem. I understand his issues. I understand, you know, what, so. About the best I can do for him, we'll see if we can find out in the next day or so, if we can find a truck going down through that way, we can find out why they're using
okay.
So, and that's about the best we can do for you right now, until we find out what's going on.
Okay. Is that satisfactory to you for us to be working on it to
yes,
see what we can?
Absolutely. I would hate for an accident to
happen.
Wow.
And there's nobody on this council that wants to see that happen.
Yeah,
and
I wasn't sure if you were aware.
Yeah, well, I wasn't aware.
And I think model traffic code requires us to do a traffic study like Shane was talking before we just change something.
Phil?
I just had a question. How long this has been going on?
I would say it's the last 9 months. It's 5 to 10 trucks every day.
I'm kind of what I'm concerned about is the 491 North rebuild, and then trucks just getting on the radio saying go to the second light and take a left, and you can miss everything, kind of thing. So, I'll get a hold of my contacts with CDOT on this project and convey that to them, and also go through and look at how they're handling traffic through their construction zone, and see what I can find out on that side.
Okay.
Thank you, guys.
Well, thank you for calling into our convention. Appreciate that. And Roy, you'll kind of keep us in the loop so we know what's going on? Okay. Thank you.
Good deal.
Any other citizen participation? Okay. There is no city attorney report. There could be something from the city manager.
I just want to remind council that we have this weekend at the Geer Natural Area. It's our first cleanup day at the Geer Natural Area, so Montezuma Land Conservancy is actually spearheading it. We're anticipating about 30 volunteers. We're going to go out there and do some trail cleanup, local trail rebuilding. And then the city is sponsoring the lunch afterwards. We're going to just barbecue, just thank our volunteers. So that's 10 to 2 at Geer. Everybody's going to meet up in the parking lot. It's on the parking lot on Cameron Road Elf. So.
Okay. Are there any committee reports?
Yes, there is. The Golf Advisory Committee met on April 27th, and we had a very spirited discussion. Some of the items that we talked about were the tournaments that had been held and some of the upcoming tournaments. Hospice tournament was coming up. I think they just finished, a par 3 tournament?
No, it's actually, it was rescheduled until the weekend of the 21st.
Because of the weather.
Yeah, the icebreaker. It was too cold.
Revenue.
Couldn't break the ice.
Yeah. We don't want it to be too cold when we're playing golf.
Golf revenue was down a little bit this year, and Micah indicated that weather was the deciding factor. They were able to start the season a lot earlier last year than this year. Staff indicated that the grass is really looking good and it's green and water's on full time, and they have numerous projects going on. Bench on 16, dedication to Glenn Layton, that's ongoing right now. And concrete, there's concrete going to be put in by the shop. Some of the cart pathways are going to be widened. One of the items of discussion was golf course access to the golf course, that discussion on where residents should enter into the golf course. Some of the people that live around the golf course, because of history many, many years ago, that they were just allowed to come in and you know, because their house was there, and now there's some discussion that they're would probably want those people to enter in one spot because some of the problems that it might have because of the accesses.
Yeah, we have a designated area on the north side of the course for cart traffic, but we don't have anything on the east side. We've had issues where, you know, adjacent property owners would just take a fence down, a city fence, and get themselves some access, which is not that good. So we're trying to figure out a solution for them to lawfully enter. And also, you know, we do have a safety issue because you're entering from that side on Fairway Drive or whatever that is. And there's holes 1 and 10 that play right into that. And since they're entering the course, we don't, you know, we're just a little bit hesitant to bring them into a situation where they could be going kind of against traffic and taking incoming fire from Dover. So anyway.
When you're playing, is that what you're talking about?
Well, luckily I don't hit it that far. So if it hits them, they probably wouldn't notice it.
Okay. Any other? Are you finished?
Oh, that's all we talked about.
You just talked about golf? Just golf at this meeting?
Yeah, we just talked about the golf course and golf.
Gosh. Any other?
I went to my first economic development. Why do you say that?
Makeda.
Okay. Anyway, I went to their first meeting tonight, and they did decide that they're going to really get on board with the broadband.
Good news.
I think they're going to let, what's the girl's name?
Chelsea?
Yes.
Chelsea. She's going to do 2/3 of her time will be spent on this broadband stuff, and they voted to put $5,000 towards it.
Is that for county-wide?
Yeah, well, it's the whole, yeah.
Yeah, so as council knows, and I've tried to keep you guys a little bit updated on the county efforts, but quite frankly, Rick and I just need to take about an hour of a workshop to catch you up, because it's been moving pretty quickly. Montezuma County has really shown a heightened interest in fiber to the home countywide. Council knows that this is something that we've discussed quite a bit and tried to work through. And then the towns of Mancos and Dolores are both interested as well. So we've been meeting in an ad hoc committee, and in addition to representatives from all those entities, Chelsea Jones from Makeda has been going to those meetings, and she's been invaluable. She's been really great, helping us survey information out, talking about how we market this and everything else. And so right now the discussion is to possibly go in front of the voters in November for a sales tax to actually do like a bonded debt and deploy fiber countywide and pay for that with the sales tax, at least pay for it with the sales tax plus user fees. So that's, there's nothing set for the ballot yet, but that's been the discussion. And because of the Fair Campaign Practice Act, no government can spend a nickel. Like if we put something on the ballot, it's just, we're done with any kind of promotion. Mm-hmm. So Makeda has agreed, I guess, at least tacitly, that they would help with the marketing of that and education of the public if it's something that goes to ballot. So I think it's great support. And I hope we can get it from 5,000 to 10,000 bit. But
keep working on them.
Yeah, keep on.
They're easy. No, I thought it was neat the way the whole, you know, all the cities and the county and everything is working together on, and they're all really excited about it being a fourth utility. And I think it's one of the best economic development things we could do right now. Mm-hmm.
She was at the town of Dolores last night with Rick and Jim McClain, and they did a really good presentation.
She's sharp. She's sharp.
Okay, any other committee reports?
I didn't actually attend the historic preservation meeting because I had another board meeting. However, Linda asked me to convey to all of you that the 7th annual Historic Preservation Day is Saturday, March 21st, over at KSJD. They're going to be having coffee, and she made up a real cool poster with pictures, and so everybody, please come.
May 21st?
May 21st. Okay. It's a Saturday.
Mm-hmm. And time?
10 o'clock. I think it's scheduled to run from 10 to noon.
Okay. All right. At the workshop, we got to meet the new Welcome Center Assistant Manager. Kelly Barbello, who is the director of Colorado Welcome Center, was down from Denver to share some figures with us. Our visitor center saw 60 million visitors last year. The park.
60 million?
60,000.
600. It was a real popular place.
Our visitor center saw more than six last year. Yeah, I'm looking at that thing. Well, that's a lot.
That's
the park Mesa Burley only had half of that.
Gonna have to extend our hours there.
Well, you know, they work fast. They got lots of volunteers.
The same guy that you kept using the bathroom. It was.
Anyway, we're expecting to have a really busy summer there this summer because of the park centennial. Jill Seyfarth and Linda Toll came to talk about CLG grants. And actually, I thought Jill gave a really nice presentation. She talked about the historical architectural significance of the City Hall. Gave me I don't want to live here anymore, but I can certainly appreciate it. Lori Johnson and Paul Holler talked about the update on the County City Mitigation Plan, so that in case we have some kind of a disaster, we have something in place. Which is not only important so that we know what to do, but it's also important if we want to get funding to help pay for damages. And Jeff Weinmeister came to give us an update on the Chamber of Commerce happenings, talked about short, mid, and long-term goals for the agency. They are kind of refreshing the Business After Hours program. They're looking at getting the chamber lunch meetings up and going again, working on a tiered membership structure so that people get to pick the services they want and pay accordingly. And then he kind of gave us a rough draft of what the chamber's been doing for the bikers tour that's supposed to be coming this summer, and making sure that all the businesses, particularly the restaurants in town, know that they've got an audience that will be in town so that they can be prepared, and just trying to work out some details so that it's a good experience for the bikers, a good experience for our local businesses, and then it hopefully lays a foundation for future bicycling, cycling events that come in to Cortez. So that was it for the workshop. Is there anything else for the good of...